twisted views of what democracy actually is. I think you're very honest in the introduction to your collection when you say it's not the ideal that's the problem, it's the working model. And you know, my take on our experience here in Britain is that people have been telling us for quite a long time that democracy is whoever just got elected, and democracy is having elections every so often, not too often, having elections, and then the winner takes all. And isn't that the problem? Not democracy the ideal, but the idea that you win an election because you've got this thumping majority or this many votes, and then you get to do what you like. And the other component parts of a democracy, it's not just the free and fair elections, we hope, but independent judges and a rule of law, and maybe some non-negotiable fundamental rights and freedoms without which democracy just kind of eats itself in the way that you seem to be describing, are just as important as having those elections. Or am I missing something?
Well, I think you're not missing much, but I think one of the things that I found quite interesting is how, you know, let's say in 1973, when the Allende government, democratically elected government, was overthrown in Chile, at that time, all across Latin America, democracy was a threat to the status quo or to, let's say, American hegemony in that continent, because democracy really meant something. You know, it really meant the will of the people was a part of the program. But now you have the opposite happening. You have them dying to install democracies because they know how to manage them. They know they have actually managed to weld democracy into the free market as if the two are Siamese twins. And then you have the very clever layered mathematics of elections. For example, I'm sure you all must have followed the joyful news of the Indian elections and the fact that the kind of secular Congress party won a thumping majority. Well, if you look at the figures, it's only 10% of the population that voted for them, for this thumping majority, you know? So what does that mean, one, to reduce democracy to just elections? Then the other thing is, let's say in India, when you have this sort of financial structure that is being pressed onto a country like India, where you have, I mean, I forgot to mention that, you know, these economic policies have resulted in 49% of Indian children being malnutritioned. 180,000 farmers have committed suicide over the last few years because they are in debt. When you press such a financial situation onto a people like this, who takes the unpopular decisions? In India, it's the Supreme Court, which has managed to become so powerful that every decision, you know, whether it's whether dams should be built, whether industry should be moved, whether slums should be cleared, whether judges should have blinking red lights on their cars, whether history books should be, you know, bigoted or not, whether, you know, what the gas in cars should be, in a CNG or petrol. Every decision is taken by the Supreme Court. And then you have the contempt of court law, which means that you cannot criticize the court.
Let's get into the judges, which I'm normally too respectful to get into the judges, and you know, in Britain they've broadly been the good guys when the executive's been the bad guys, but you've been to prison for contempt of court. I kind of wonder whether I should even be seen in public with you. So tell us about that. How does that happen? How does the Supreme Court of you know, the world's largest democracy end up putting you in prison for contempt of court?
Well, the world's largest democracy was described by a Kashmiri protester who held up a placard saying, "Democracy without justice equals demon crazy." And that sort of sums it up. The Supreme Court is very, very supreme. And if you look at some of the judgments that they've come out with, it's unbelievable. And that you cannot challenge it is even more unbelievable. I'll just tell you a few. One of them, when on the 13th of December 2001, the Indian Parliament was attacked, and there's a lot of writing on that, which it was an outrageous story. The Parliament was attacked, and five terrorists were killed, and then L.K. Advani, who was a home minister, said, "Oh, they look like Pakistanis. They must be Pakistanis." Then they arrested four people. One of them, who they said was the mastermind of the case, was a lecturer in Arabic in Delhi University. And the other three were, all of them were Kashmiris. And after the trial, the mastermind was acquitted, after a huge campaign by many of us. The other two were acquitted of the charges against them. One of them was imprisoned for a minor charge. And the third one, Afzal, was sentenced to death. And I've quoted it in here, the Supreme Court judgment actually says that, we couldn't find any direct evidence against him, and the evidence is only circumstantial. And then a few paragraphs down, it goes on to say, but in order to satisfy the collective conscience of society, we are sentencing him to death.
In order to satisfy the collective conscience of society, despite the lack of evidence, we're going to sentence him to death.
And through the period of the trial, those of us who were following it and writing about it and working on it showed how evidence had been fabricated, how seizure memos had been forged, how arrest memos were wrong, how witnesses had lied. It didn't matter. Even when they accepted it, they just sort of shook a finger at the police, and then he sentenced this man to three death sentences. That's one. On the other hand, you have, for example, this whole story of mining that I was talking about. You had a Supreme Court judge saying, "Tribals have no place in this story." When you're talking about what anthropologists call cultural genocide of 15,000-20,000 people who've always lived their lives in this forest and just thrown out. He says they have no place in the story. Another one said, "Oh, I have shares in this company. It's a very good company."
A judge said.
Yes, in court.
This is a Supreme Court judge.
Yeah.
Said during a hearing of a case in which that he had shares in the company.
Actually, it's a little complicated. This company, Vedanta.
That's living complicated to me. Yeah.
Vedanta is a company that's been listed in the London Stock Exchange, mining bauxite in Orissa. The Norwegian government's ethics fund, or ethics council or something, said that they blacklisted it for various reasons. So in the judgment, this judge said, "Okay, let's leave Vedanta out. We'll give it to Sterlite. I have shares in it. It's an Indian company, but Vedanta is a subsidiary of Sterlite. It's the same company. It's a joke." Similarly, another judge, again a judgment I've quoted here. At the same time that hundreds of thousands of people were being thrown out of their homes and their little businesses were being sealed in Delhi, making space for the Asian Games, and they were all being called illegal businesses. There was a big, huge, illegal mall being built in a place called Vasant Kunj. It didn't have the requisite permissions. And the same judge, who said tribals have no place in the story, gave a judgment in which he said, But it's not an individual, it's a corporation, and corporations cannot be accused of malpractice.